look at the Bible. Let's look in the book of Job. Turn to chapter 40. In verse 15 we're told of a mighty creature that Job must have known. In the jungle of the reeds and ferns, Behemoth made his home. Behemoth is a dinosaur.
In a recent video, I discussed the ancient Near Eastern background of the creature Leviathan found in the Book of Job. Because Leviathan shows up in the literature of ancient Israel's neighbors with the exact same titles and serving similar functions, it is well established that he was a mythic personification of cosmic, watery chaos. Not only does the dragon breathe fire in Job, but in Psalm 74, the Hebrew grammar describes him as a hydra with multiple heads. But what is the creature Behemoth described immediately next to Leviathan? Some creationists are strongly convinced that Behemoth was a sauropod dinosaur like a brachiosaurus still loitering around in Job's day.
And you know, there's even indication in the Bible of a dinosaur that lived beside a man after the flood. Go and read the book of Job, Job chapter 40, verse 15. Behemoth, the largest land animal God made, the description fits something like a sauropod dinosaur living with Job after the flood.
There are several reasons why we can safely say that Behemoth wasn't a dinosaur. To begin with, as any first-year Hebrew student will surely recognize, the name Behemoth is etymologically built on a run-of-the-mill Hebrew word frequently used for cattle, behemah. Bernard F. Bateau, a Hebraist at DePaul University who has specialized in the ancient Near Eastern context of Behemoth, has pointed out that if anything, linguistically the connotation therefore suggests that this is a sort of super-ox. Second, there is also nothing whatsoever in the passage that describes him as reptilian, something we would reasonably expect if this were a brachiosaurus. Third, what's most notable about a sauropod-like brachiosaurus? That its neck is 85 feet long. Its entire biomorphology is framed around feeding from the tops of trees. If the author of Job was bragging about a sauropod's features and amazing physical capacity, you would think he would have mentioned these distinctions other than the pitiful line, "He feeds on grass like an ox." Expecting the Job author to omit the business about its nine stories of neck seems about as unlikely as me bragging about a giraffe's features and forgetting to mention its neck. But what about where the Bible says he extends his tail like a cedar? Isn't this evidence that Job saw living dinosaurs? There's just one minor complication. This line about Behemoth's tail probably doesn't refer to a literal tail. It's much more likely a cultural euphemism for his male appendage. That explanation may not preach as well on a Sunday morning, but it isn't some sort of new-spun liberalization by pointy-headed academics. It's very ancient, acknowledged in most academic commentaries, and is firmly supported by the lexical evidence. To illustrate, notice that the portion of the poem describing Behemoth's body uses Liszt parallelism, a classical Hebrew technique in which each line or colon echoes the thought of the previous. "Behold, his strength is in his loins, and his power in the muscles of his belly. He extends his tail like a cedar. The sinews of his testicles are knit together. His bones are tubes of bronze, his limbs like bars of iron." Now consider the following 4 points. 1. In the poetic verse structure, tail is parallel with the Hebrew word pachad. Pachad only appears once in the Bible, but we know its meaning through Aramaic and a cognate Arabic word. It literally refers to the thighs, but the point of the connotation as it's plainly used in Aramaic literature is that it was a locution for the testicles. This is why the KJV translates the word stones. It's also why ancient Jewish scholars like Rashi and Ibn Ezra interpreted it as the testicles. The Latin Vulgate likewise clarifies its connotation to the readers by translating it as testiculorum, and some modern Hebrew experts like Robert Alter have also opted for similar translations. The couplet parallelism of these two lines therefore anticipates a synonym for the testicles in the place where you see that word tail. 2. In his article discussing the poetic structure of this passage in the Journal for the Study of the Old Testament, David Bernat also points out that a reproductive euphemism makes sense of the odd verb associated with Behemoth's tail. Explaining it as his masculine appendage creates a clever use of double meaning in the poem. This Hebrew verb, chafetz, refers to extending or making stiff or even moving as most translations render it in the passage. But we know the word also frequently connotes meanings like desire and delight. Taking Behemoth's tail as a euphemism for his male appendage plays off both of these meanings and logically supports the surrounding verses extolling features of strength. Behold, his strength is in his loins, the sinews of his testicles are knit. The verb in its surrounding context therefore supports a reproductive euphemism. 3. Bernard also points out that the term translated strength here, as in his strength is in his loins, also refers to reproductive virility in other passages. He cites Genesis 49:3, Deuteronomy 21:17, and Psalm 105:36 as examples of this. So the phrase, his strength is in his loins, again coheres nicely with a reproductive euphemism. And 4. Finally, we know that ancient post-biblical Hebrew also used the same word tail as a euphemism for the male appendage. Post-biblical Hebrew therefore also lends evidence to a reproductive euphemism. So the poetic parallelism, verbal use, connotation of the surrounding language, and post-biblical linguistics all support the conclusion that Behemoth's tail is his reproductive anatomy. Some young earthers may object that these points are just a slick bit of Freudian gymnastics. After all, if Job is referring to a creature's male appendage, why not just say it rather than using a confusing euphemism? The answer to this objection is that it would be weird if Job wasn't being euphemistic. Biblical literature is remarkably creative about referring to sexual anatomy due to a linguistic process called euphemism creep. Euphemism creep happens when a culture doesn't like to refer to a thing directly. Because they shy away from using some direct term, they tend to accumulate all sorts of creative locutions for indirectly communicating it. But the long and short of it is that the Bible almost always uses euphemisms for sexual anatomy, so the fact that Job would use one here is something that we ought to expect, and the parallel structure of the poetry anticipates it. Considering all this, what then is Behemoth? Given that he appears in the Texan dyad with a dragon used in ancient literature as a personification of oceanic chaos, Behemoth is probably the personification of the terrestrial aspect of the created order, especially of the animal kingdom. Not only is this how early Jewish extra-biblical texts understood him, but it would also correspond quite nicely with a reference made in the Ugaritic texts. Recall that ancient Ugarit is linguistically the best extra-biblical material we've got for contextualizing ancient Israel's northwest Semitic culture. Quote, "Surely I lifted up the dragon, I destroyed the twisting serpent, the tyrant with the seven heads. I destroyed Arshu, beloved of El, and put an end to El's calf, Attic." So the Ugaritic version of Leviathan, who's also called the Twisting Serpent, just so happens to be paired with a mythical bullock, literally called the Calf of God. When we look at the main biblical passage that talks about Leviathan, what do we find? He's paired with the super bullock also, an intensified form of the common Hebrew word for cattle. It seems unlikely that this similar pairing is merely a coincidence, and many scholars routinely find it to be our most reasonable identification with the limited data that we have. We don't know much about the divine bull Attic, but we do have precedents for other divine bulls and other ancient Near Eastern texts. In the Epic of Gilgamesh, for example, the goddess Diana sends the tremendous bull of heaven to defeat the heroes Gilgamesh and Enkidu, one so great that it, quote, drank the water of a river in great slurps. With each slurp it used up 1 mile of the river, but its thirst was not satisfied. This is somewhat reminiscent to what we read of Behemoth. Behold, he drinks up a river, restraining its rush. He trusts that he can draw up the Jordan into his mouth. Third, Job says that Behemoth dwells, quote, in the shelter of the reeds in the marsh. Psalm 68:30 similarly describes bulls as dwellers, quote, among reeds. And the Ugaritic texts likewise use a cognate term to describe bulls that inhabited marshy regions. Finally, Job praises the reproductive virility of this creature. In the agrarian culture of the ancient Near East, bulls were the go-to symbol of reproductive virility. So Behemoth is a bovine personification of the animal kingdom, and perhaps of the whole of the terrestrial realm itself, a supernatural counterpart to Leviathan. The Job passage is trying to teach us a lesson about God's domination over the cosmic order and man's weakness by comparison. Some are adverse to such an interpretation since it means that Job is drawing again on characters from Semitic mythology. But I think this attitude places far too many restrictions on Job's literary genius. If you want to learn more about the stranger aspects of ancient Israelite religion, this video is an adaptation of a new book I've got coming down the pike. Stick around and I'll be producing more content like it. We will eventually be looking at the ancient Near Eastern context of the 7 days of Genesis. Thanks to modern archaeological discoveries, we now know that there's a lot more going on with the days of the creation account than most old and young earth creationists realize. And it has implications for how we view the relationship between science and the Bible.